Welcome to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. U.S. stocks hitting new records with tech shares again leading the way. And Apple again driving markets higher. Apple and Google unveiling an update to their COVID tracking partnership. iPhones will now have the ability to contact trace without an app as of today. Android phones will be ready within a month. The company's hoping this will spark more adoption, but it'll only work where public health officials offer apps to utilize this technology. This as new cases of COVID-19 are now dropping in many states across the country, but still rising in the Midwest. The U.S. still grappling with how and when to reopen safely. New York public schools just postponed in-person return for 3 more weeks. Let's get back to the markets, though, with our Abigail Doolittle in New York, who's been following all the back and forth. Abigail, generally, another up day driven by Apple.
Another up day. That basically summarizes it, Emily. It feels as though that's pretty much every day for us. And yes, Apple, a big driver there for sure. So the bulls certainly in charge. This Fed liquidity-driven, fueled rally that we've had right out of the March lows continuing right into September. We now have 5 up months in a row, and September is starting off with more record highs. So perhaps in 30 days, we'll be there once again. The S&P 500 gaining by 0.75%. The NASDAQ 100 up 1.5%. The top point boost, as you were alluding to, Apple. And Apple really helping out the chip space as well, because there's some indications that they could have a very strong season relative to selling iPhones. So you see the stocks up 2%. Interestingly, there's one tell in the possibility that some investors are a little cautious. We're seeing a little bit of a rally for bonds, Haven bonds, that 10-year yield down nearly 4 basis points. So let's keep an eye on that. One day a trend does not make, but if that continues into tomorrow, it tells you that investors are a little bit nervous that maybe that this rally is long in the tooth, but not today all that much. And speaking of big movers outside of Apple and some of those chip companies that include Nvidia and Broadcom that were up, we also have Walmart and Amazon up in a huge way. Take a look at Walmart, up 6.3%. It's best day since early July. And this, Emily, as they are finally taking on Amazon Prime, they are launching Walmart Plus in about 2 weeks. It will cost $98 for 1 year relative to Amazon Prime at $119. And it will enable subscribers to receive free delivery of all of their products, plus groceries and discounts on gas. So they're really going after Amazon Prime pretty hard. But Amazon investors don't appear all that worried. Those shares up 1.4% as these mega caps in many sectors are just rallying on the day.
Potentially huge development for Walmart there. We'll certainly see how it impacts the competition, namely Amazon. I do want to talk a little bit more about Apple. We spoke to Matt Mela yesterday of Miller Tabak. He said the run-up in the shares of Apple and both Tesla, he believes, is undeserved, and we're going to see steep declines on the back end of this following the stock splits. What's your take?
So it's interesting. I heard that interview. Great interview, Emily. A lot of analysts typically aren't quite as aggressive on air. But frankly, the technical support Matt Maley's call completely. If we go into the Bloomberg terminal and take a look at a one-year chart of Apple, we are going to see a grossly overextended stock. This stock right now, the shares of Apple, 75% above the 200-day moving average, actually 66%, but still, that's quite a bit. To put that into perspective, before February, Apple was only, and I say only because this is still a huge amount, 42% above its 200-day moving average. That's the degree to which the buyers are more enthusiastic than the long-term buyers, because that yellow line, that represents the long-term buying support. At some point, Apple will drop back down to that 200-day moving average. It's happened time after time over the last couple of years, typically around iPhone cycles. Matt Mela yesterday saying he wouldn't be surprised to see 20%. Well, if we do get that drop down to that 200-day moving average, if that were to happen, say, over the next weeks or months, that would be a 30 to 40% drop. So he's completely in line. And take a look at this 10-year chart, that parabolic uptrend. They reverse. So even though they're scheduling 75 million iPhone sales, could be tough sailing ahead for the shares of Apple at some point, Emily.
All right. We will be watching and talking more about Apple right now. Bloomberg's Abigail Doolittle, thank you so much for that update. Meantime, on Apple, Apple's 75 million iPhone target for the coming fall season. We are joined by Bloomberg's Mark Gurman, who covers the company for us and helped break this story, Mark. So we have learned that Apple is targeting 75 million iPhones for the fall. Tell us more about what we know and what this means.
So we know that they've asked their suppliers to build between 75 and 80 million 5G phones, as you said. And what that indicates is that there's going to be a similar target for sales through this year as they had last year and the year before, which means that despite the pandemic, despite the economic slowdown, despite everything going on in the world, Apple is anticipating the status quo for their own sales of their most important products. So that's good news for the company and good news for investors, certainly.
You always have a pretty good lead on other forthcoming products. You've reported they're planning to announce a couple of new Apple Watches this fall, a new iPad, some over-the-ear headphones. Tell us more about what you know.
Yeah, so it's going to be another jam-packed holiday season for Apple. In addition to those four phones, there's going to be a over-the-ear headphone, which should be quite popular. These will be basically AirPods on steroids. They'll be over-the-ear. First time they'll be doing over-ear headphones, not with the Beats branding. These will be Apple branded. There's going to be a new, smaller, cheaper HomePod, which could hopefully, for them, help boost their smart home situation, where they've very much lagged behind Google and Amazon and other companies in that space. There'll be a new iPad Air, which is their $500 to $600 mid-tier tablet, which could, you know, continue to increase sales of that line, which saw some success in the third fiscal quarter, as you know. And so it's going to be a pretty packed, you know, fall for the company, in addition to those two Apple Watches that you mentioned.
I do want to talk about this new contact tracing partnership that has been slow to take off the ground between Apple and Google. Some new announcements today that iPhones, as of now, have the capability to contact trace, but only in tandem, as I understand it, with apps from typically public health officials. What exactly did they tell us today, and how well is this technology actually working so far?
So the news is that now on the iPhone specifically, with an update called 13.7 that came out today, you'll be able to use contact tracing without actually installing or downloading an app from a public health authority. The problem is that this portion of the service is only available in three states plus Washington, D.C., so four parts of the U.S., and this component is U.S. only. On the Android side, they sort of are not doing as much as Apple's doing in terms of not requiring an app. The difference is that the iPhone will require no app, whereas on Android, they're actually going to start building the apps for the public health authorities themselves, which tells you all you need to know. These public health authorities have really not gotten it together. In total, only six states in the U.S. and 20 countries, not particularly big countries, have adopted this. So there is a lot of room to grow. And, you know, hopefully, you know, just hopefully coronavirus is gone by the time people need to start complaining about this service only being in a very limited amount of places.
So what's it going to take for this to actually take off, for people to realize the need and, you know, take advantage of this?
Yeah, you know, I think Google's approach to actually build the apps for the public health authorities, I mean, is really the best option, right? I mean, they're basically saying, hey, you guys aren't going to build it, so we're going to build them. But as of today, only three states plus Washington, D.C., out of, you know, all the hundreds of countries around the world, and obviously the 50 states in the U.S., it's not a lot of penetration. So, you know, we'll see, you know, how many more states to get on board by the fall and for how long this is really going to be necessary.
Meantime, looking forward to the products you're expecting them to unveil this fall. We're expecting the launch to happen in October rather than September, when it typically happens normally. Mark, you and I are preparing for this to roll out next week, the second week of September. That, to our understanding, is not happening. How will that impact Apple's sales for the holiday quarter, which is typically the biggest quarter for the company?
Yeah, now to be clear, there might be a few products, some of the more minor products during this month of September. The iOS 14 update will come out this month. But I think the iPhones will be announced at an event of some sort in October. In terms of sales, I think they already priced in for their, you know, internal guidance. They haven't really announced external guidance because of coronavirus, that these phones won't launch until several weeks after. I think the interesting thing to see is how long the staggered launch is going to be. So my anticipation is we'll start to see the cheaper new iPhone 12s launch around third week October, and maybe the Pro models more toward the end of October, early November. So you're going to see a little bit of a drawback from that, of course, for the Q1 holiday quarter. What that might do is set Apple up for a strong Q2 as well in 2021.
All right. Mark Gurman on top of it all, as always, will be following the drumbeat to October. Thank you. Coming up, the deadline is rapidly approaching for TikTok to sell its U.S. operations. But is the company even close to a deal? That's coming up next. This is Bloomberg. Time is running out for TikTok to sell its U.S. operations. President Trump chimed in today on why the U.S., he believes, should be compensated.
Well, I told them that they have till September 15th to make a deal. After that, we close it up in this country. And I said that the United States has to be compensated, well compensated, because we are the ones that are making it possible. And so we should be compensated. So the Treasury has to be well compensated.
Joining us now, Alfred Chuang, a general partner at Race Capital, who closely follows the company. Alfred, thank you so much for joining us. You actually sold a company to Oracle back in the day, and Oracle is one of the players that has submitted a bid for TikTok, in addition to Microsoft and Walmart going in as partners. Do you think Oracle would make a good home for TikTok?
Emily, thank you for having me. Well, it's this is obviously a very interesting deal. We don't even know what's going to happen. So Oracle is an excellent company in acquiring companies. I think there's no rival in the industry how well they know how to do this. They're pros. Larry and Safra really know how to buy companies. Obviously, in terms of the fit,
this, what are the pros? What do you mean by that?
Well, I think in this particular case for TikTok, obviously we have the challenge where TikTok's 69% of the users are Gen Zs. They're 16 to 24 years old. That really isn't Oracle's demographics of their users. So if Oracle's going to buy them, then Oracle will have to probably go down the same road that Microsoft has already done with something like LinkedIn. They will have to build a division. They have to nurture it. They have to run it outside of the current business. So that means Oracle will now be foray into the consumer and also the ad business itself. It is not far-fetched. You know, I think Oracle's P&E ratio is relatively modest at this point in time. Looking for things to grow outside of the core domain, I think, is a reasonable thing. And you know, in terms of people that really know how to buy a company, situate it, and make it productive, they're very good at that.
Now, as you alluded to, this is a very complicated deal. You have the Chinese government now saying that they would have to approve it. It's you wonder why the Chinese government would approve such a deal at all. And so there's certainly a lot of risks there. If you are Microsoft and Walmart or Oracle, why even embark on such an uncertain endeavor?
Well, Emily, things changed this weekend, right? So until yesterday, we obviously, including myself, we were all questioning exactly what is included in this deal. So we're talking about selling the U.S. operations of TikTok. That's really not very valuable. The crown jewel of this deal is really the learning algorithm that is sitting as part of ByteDance's overall portfolio. So they have that actually obviously deep in Beijing and China. So I've always been questioning, are they selling that? How do they sell that? Do they sell a one-time source code rights to the buyer? And then they will also have to now clean up the database. So the U.S. operations data, obviously that would be included. But that could be also be data that they have in that mass or summarized that actually sitting in Beijing itself, that also will have to be cleaned up. So now adding the Chinese Commerce Ministry that will have to put 45 days of review into it, that's way surpass President Trump's timeline of this deal have to be closed in 45 days from a couple weeks back. So we're gonna be very short of time to make anything happen.
Now, What happens in this deal and what has happened so far is incredibly unprecedented, even in the long and complicated relationship between the United States and China. How do you believe what happens here will impact or could potentially impact U.S.-China relations for years and perhaps decades to come, as well as the cross-border investment that happens between the two countries and the tech industries in both countries as well?
Well, Emily, obviously, the impact is profound, because just look at what the U.S. has done with CFIUS, right? So once CFIUS is done, even giants like Ant Financial really wanted to buy MoneyGram, and they couldn't buy MoneyGram. So their implication to the things that just now we've seen from CFIUS, of the things that the Chinese wanted to do, they can do in this direction. So if we go down the same route that now there's going to be a Chinese CFIUS, which is kind of the indication of where this is heading to, so that will mean there will be things that the U.S. would like to be acquiring or including or licensing, we're going to have exactly the same impact. Now, I think the bigger issue is, here's the thing. So ByteDance on its own is a very, very brilliant company, right? So now I think it's for the first time the U.S. company have seen how good the Chinese engineers are in terms of building machine learning algorithm and be able to basically break the market in 200 days and amass 250 million users. So with that in mind, it's going to be very tricky to think, it won't hurt ByteDance. ByteDance has a big portfolio. They have many applications, all in the hundreds of millions of users range. And this is really the U.S. operation for TikTok is not a big revenue generating business compared to the overall portfolio. So they could easily go and create another app, bring it in. So I guess then what is our role? The Treasury Department would become a sovereign investment banker and not brokering all of these deals, or we're going to be implementing policy, or even worse, we're now going to create a U.S. Firewall that preventing us to use Chinese apps. And all the things that we complain about, how China's been doing it, that the Google and the Facebook and the Slack and the Twitter cannot get into China. Now we're going to do the same thing to them. So that would make sense.
That's fascinating.
Yeah.
That's quite a scenario you lay out there, and it really is anyone's guess how this plays out. Certainly some fascinating things to think about. Alfred Chuang, thank you so much for joining us, general partner at Race Capital. Coming up, with joblessness in the U.S. on the rise and unemployment payments shrinking, competition for gig work is stiffening. Now, freelance Amazon drivers are resorting to extreme methods to get deliveries first. More on that ahead. This is Bloomberg. A strange phenomenon has emerged near Amazon delivery stations and Whole Foods stores in the Chicago suburbs. Smartphones dangling from trees. Contract delivery drivers are putting the merit to get a jump on rivals waiting to pick up orders. Here with the story, we've got Spencer Soper, who covers Amazon for us. So, Spencer, what exactly is happening here?
Delivery drivers are basically staking out these routes by trying to get as close to Whole Foods as possible. And the phones are what Amazon system looks for when it assigns routes. If it has a route that has to be done immediately, it is looking for drivers that are close by. So these drivers are combining both a phone in the tree to have the closest proximity to Amazon, along with some sort of software running on the device to snag the route as soon as it becomes available.
Wow. What is Amazon saying about this?
Amazon didn't talk to us about this. We did see a note that they sent to a driver. So some drivers are concerned because they feel like if they're not in on this plot, then they're losing work. You know, it's some people are benefiting and others are missing out, and they have complained. And we saw an email that Amazon sent in response to those drivers just saying that they'd investigate the matter, and if there are any intermediaries, you know, trying to game its system, that that's a violation of their policies. But they said that they would not be able to divulge whatever they determine from their investigation with the drivers. So the drivers are frustrated, just saying it just continues to happen, and Amazon doesn't seem to be doing anything about it.
Well, it's certainly a very creative solution, but also a sign of some of the desperation out there and how desperate some people are to get work. How were you alerted to this story?
Yeah, so definitely, and, you know, this is the gig economy, correct? So it's not like an hourly worker who's getting paid even when the shift is a little slow. These are people who only get paid if they get the Amazon delivery job. And so they're sitting there and looking for any way possible to get that job, which could pay as little as $15. And so it is kind of a sign of the times. And it's also, you know, shows how the gig economy, particularly in a tough, bleak job market, the people with the work really benefit because they'll have, you know, big lines of people waiting to get that work. And it doesn't hurt Amazon to have a bunch of people milling around outside Whole Foods waiting to get a delivery route. It doesn't cost Amazon a nickel, and then it makes their deliveries faster.
You know, Amazon has touted how many people they've hired in the midst of this pandemic. How exactly are they handling delivery operations across the country? How much do they use Amazon Flex versus like UPS, FedEx, and other delivery services?
Yeah, so Amazon really has a sophisticated delivery network. It can use those providers, like you mentioned, UPS, the Postal Service. It has its own dedicated fleet of Amazon. You know, people see the blue Amazon vans also making deliveries, and all those handle a large amount of the capacity. And what Flex does, this is an Uber-like app, so it's similar to somebody picking you up in their Toyota Prius and driving you to the airport. You know, that person can also download the Amazon Flex app and make deliveries for Amazon in their spare time. And so it's just another part of this system, but it's the only part that operates in like the gig economy model, and that's why this is getting gamed in this way.
All right. Bloomberg Spencer Soper, thank you so much for your great reporting there. We'll continue to follow that story. Coming up, Tesla gearing up production with a huge stock offering. It's clear skies and tailwinds. Also for Amazon's drone delivery program. We're going to take a look at that next. This is Bloomberg. Welcome back to Bloomberg Technology. I'm Emily Chang. Tesla announcing today the company will be selling up to $5 billion in shares as Elon Musk prepares for growth in production. After a surge in the stock recently, the news has caused shares of the company to drop close to 5% in intraday trading. With us now, Tasha Keeney, an analyst at ARK Invest, which has Tesla as a top holding for three of the firm's funds. Tasha, great to have you back with us. So obviously Tesla has been doing well on the back of this stock split. What's your take on this latest announcement that the company is going to be selling up to $5 billion in shares?
Well, yeah, I think the company's taking advantage of its current market cap. I think obviously this would allow Tesla to produce more vehicles, which from our perspective is a good thing, right? So, you know, you and I have talked about autonomous cars and Tesla's future in that market many times before. I mean, the more cars that Tesla has on the road means the more data it's collecting, and it's really furthering that goal as well. So, you know, at ARK, we're long-term investors. We've always been looking 5 years out or more at our companies. So we're happy that Tesla is investing for growth and is just looking to make as many cars as it possibly can.
Elon Musk also just surpassed Mark Zuckerberg as the third richest person in the world because of the rise that we've seen in Tesla's stock. What is your outlook, though, on growth as the pandemic continues? Still more uncertainty ahead. Yes, people want more private modes of transportation, but people aren't commuting as much. And there are a lot of people out there struggling. We're in a recession. They don't necessarily have the money to spend on a new car.
Yeah, well, you know, Tesla showed that graph in its last earnings report. Basically, it's the only automaker that's really seen growth in this time. So I think I'm more concerned about the rest of the auto industry in this pandemic. I mean, if you're a traditional automaker and you're trying to shift towards electric vehicles, you're trying to shift towards autonomous technology, and you have to invest in that, when your core business is failing, that just becomes a much harder problem. And to really rally behind something that you have to, again, pour money into to make it happen, it's just even harder to do that when you have to deal with layoffs and sort of cutting what's not crucial at the company. And maybe you're even focusing on selling trucks because that's what that sells in periods like this. So I think if anything, it really solidifies Tesla's position as a leader in electric vehicles and as a technology player in the auto market. You're absolutely right that, you know, as for the auto industry as a whole, this is not a great year, but for EVs long-term, you know, we see battery costs declining. That's going to continue. Electric vehicles will be cheaper than gas-powered cars. That's going to cause a massive demand switch towards EVs. And then a player like Tesla is a leader in the space again. So that'll only boost them.
Interesting. I do want to get your thoughts on this Amazon advancement in drone delivery. Obviously, Amazon, another big holding for ARK Invest. The company has gotten FAA approval for commercial drone drops. This has always been sort of in the futuristic future, but maybe the futuristic future is finally here now, and Amazon is planning its first commercial drops by drone in the United States. What's your take on this?
Yeah, I'm really excited for this announcement. So I've been researching drones for over 5 years now. We wrote a piece a while ago saying that Amazon could deliver packages by drone for less than a dollar. And drones, compared to autonomous cars, have always been held back by regulation, in particular in the U.S. And that's why companies like Amazon and Google have actually gone abroad to test the technology. So to see a home regulator, getting these approvals passed and allowing this technology to move forward, that's really exciting just for the U.S. in particular. But for drone delivery, I mean, if you look at e-commerce as a percentage of retail, it was 15% last year. I'm sure this year it's only going to be higher with the pandemic. We think that could actually go to 60% of retail by 2030, and drones could deliver over half of that. So we think this could be, a market that's worth over $100 billion by 2030. And certainly for a player like Amazon, it really solidifies their position as sort of this logistics Goliath. So I think that'll only, help e-commerce and change consumer shopping behavior as well.
Wow. So we should all start clearing space in front of our homes for a landing pad.
Absolutely.
Okay. Tasha Keeney of ARK Invest. Absolutely. Thank you so much, as always, for joining us today on the show. Fascinating to hear your insights. Now, at a time when the mission and means of law enforcement is under heavy scrutiny in the United States, Axon, the company known to provide police body cameras, is out with a number of new tools for police officers using technology. I sat down with CEO Rick Smith and asked how Axon technology can play a role in police reform.
I think part of the reason that, candidly, we're seeing this level of energy right now is because of the transparency. In the case of what happened with George Floyd, I think because that was captured in so much detail, including with police body cameras, the truth had nowhere to hide. And what makes this different from every other incident in the past is that every major police chief I know of has come out, and for the first time I've seen this happen, they've said, you know what, this was wrong and police need to change. If we go back to Michael Brown or previous cases, there was always so much uncertainty. Well, we don't know if Mr. Brown was assaulting the officer or not. Here, this level of transparency is creating real impetus for change. Now, unfortunately, that also is coming with a lot of anguish and social turmoil. But I at least am hopeful that this energy is going to translate into meaningful change.
Your mission, you say, is to make the bullet obsolete through your portfolio of technology, which includes body cams, tasers, VR simulations. How exactly do you plan to do that?
Well, in its simplest, if we make non-lethal weapons effective and reliable enough that police don't have to go to their firearms, I mean, that's the ultimate goal. We're not there yet. Today, the reason police go to lethal force is it remains the most reliable way to stop a threat. But that is a technology problem, and we're working actively on solving it. And then all these other pieces around body cameras and police training are about optimizing a police agency's ability to hold its own members accountable, to train them better, and to at least minimize the risks to the degree that's possible.
The main criticism of body cameras, though, is that police can withhold the footage if it makes them look bad, which throws the accountability out the window.
Yeah, I think that's a mischaracterization. I mean, there are challenges around protecting people's privacy. For example, if police are involved in an incident, some people would say, well, they should just release all the video. Well, in some cases, you have child victims and others there, so there needs to be redaction of that video before it's released. But I would say the trajectory of history is that these videos are being released. Just a few years ago, LAPD had a policy of releasing no body camera videos. Now they have a policy of releasing every single one of them that involves any sort of use of force. And I think that's going to continue to move in that direction.
Tell us about the VR simulations and training that you provide. For example, a violent protest like what we've seen in Portland over the weekend, how could your technology help officers respond there?
Well, where I think the technology can help is actually in a more everyday sort of scenario. I mean, these protests are certainly challenging, but something that happens all the time is police have to deal with people with mental health issues, schizophrenics, people that might be suicidal. And we're using VR to give police officers a chance to go through those scenarios and practice them in a highly immersive way. And not only experiencing what it's like to be a police officer in those roles, but we actually give them the chance to step into what it's like for a person on the receiving end of a police interaction. And what we're hearing, both from psychological experts and from law enforcement who've been through the training, is that that is a powerful tool. Because it's one thing to go, hey, here's a PowerPoint with 10 checkboxes about what you should or shouldn't do with dealing with somebody who's schizophrenic. That's way different than actually going through an immersive 360 video experience where you're actually experiencing what it's like for that person. And we're hoping that that would give police the tools to better understand how they can interact effectively.
So what police departments are you working with?
So we work with the vast majority of police departments across the country. Whether it's with our taser weapons or body cameras, it's pretty hard to find a police department that we don't have some sort of relationship with today.
Now, given that you've got many police departments facing funding shortages, where does that leave Axon? You know, often new technology can be one of the first things that gets cut.
Well, as it turns out, with police departments, the vast majority, like over 90% of their budget goes to personnel-related costs. And so, unfortunately, you know, if there is a cut in funding, that means it's going to translate into reductions in headcount. And what we've seen historically is if that happens, the agencies actually have to focus more on spending on technology to automate things that previously they did with, you know, with human capital.
What's your vision for how policing looks different, let's say, 20 years from now? Do you imagine that things will have dramatically changed?
20 years from now, police shootings are going to be exceedingly rare. In fact, if we do our job right, they may never happen in 20 years.
Really? How?
The only reason police shoot and kill people today is because it is the only truly reliable way to stop a threat. That is a technology problem. The minute that police have the equivalent of the phaser, there will be no legal justification for them to shoot and kill someone. Now, I want to tell you, that is a high bar to hit technologically, but you gave me 20 years, and we'll do it in 10.
Well, I just have to push back there a little bit, because it's, you know, they might think it's the only way to stop a threat, but the question is it really a threat? And is that kind of force necessary in that
moment?
Oh,
for sure. Those are legitimate questions in any of these individual incidents. The challenge is, if you put yourself in the police officer's shoes, when they're, you know, they're human beings as well, they're scared right now with what's going on, they're under tremendous stress, and yes, sometimes they make bad decisions, but I can tell you today, standard police training is, if they fear for their life, the thing in their hand is a gun, because today, that is the only thing sufficiently reliable that they would bet their life on it, and that is the problem we're working to solve. We need to give them something so reliable they would bet their own life on something else.
Interesting predictions there, Axon CEO Rick Smith. All right, coming up, women entrepreneurs still face an alarming set of obstacles in the startup ecosystem. We are going to hear from Pam Kostka, CEO of Allraise, a nonprofit that's trying to amplify women's voices in the often male-dominated tech industry. She joins us next. This is Bloomberg. Research continues to show that women remain deeply underrepresented in the startup ecosystem. Only 12% of decision makers at venture capital firms in the United States are women, and just 12% of VC funds go to teams with at least one female founder. The statistics are even worse for women of color. To discuss new efforts to break the patterns that are holding back female entrepreneurs, we're joined by Pam Kostka, CEO of Allraise. Pam, thank you so much for joining us. Allraise has been at this now for 3 years, gone through the Me Too movement, now the Black Lives Matter movement, and at this very moment, a global pandemic. How much progress do you believe there's actually been over the last 3 years in terms of representation for women in the startup ecosystem?
There has been, you know, there's highlights and there's lowlights across the spectrum. When we started, women in venture capital were at 9%. We're now up to 12%, making steady progress every year. Unfortunately, the amount of funding going to female founders has remained relatively flat. So we're still at about 11 to 12% of funding going to female founders, somebody who, team doesn't have to be all female, but at least one female founder on the team. So there have been fits and starts. We like to say we're still in the first mile of the race. This is a marathon. We have a long way to go. So there's promise, but we still have a lot of work ahead of us.
Now, the representation of women in stories and media is also important. It's something that we're trying very hard here at Bloomberg to improve, and something that we work on every day to make sure that our show is a representation of all different kinds of voices. Allraise is now launching something called the Visionary Voices Initiative to help raise female voices across the board. How exactly will this work?
Yeah, we wanted to make sure that we were not perpetuating a cycle where women don't have the same access to opportunities and networks as men. And that includes access to media opportunities, panel opportunities to showcase their expertise. So we created an open access directory of almost 1,000 highly qualified women to make it easy for conference organizers, media, people who are putting together a panel to be inclusive of women, especially underrepresented women, in various settings. And so we want to make sure that we're amplifying their voices, making sure that they have equal opportunity and access. So we have an open source directory on our website, open to anybody. We've partnered with a variety of organizations, from conference organizers like Startup Grind and Saster, to media outlets like Fast Company and Protocol, to engage and use this. It's not just limited to our partners, though. Anybody has access on our website. We highly encourage as well, if you're a speaker, one of the important things is that you use your influence and privilege and invitation as a speaker to create space at the table for others. And so as a speaker, you too can use this, or encourage those who are outreaching to you to use this resource for their own purposes as well.
Absolutely. What trends are you seeing in the pandemic more broadly? You know, I've been thinking a lot about the fact that you've got a lot of companies going through layoffs, companies that are just trying to survive. And I wonder if then diversity becomes less of a priority because companies are just trying to figure out how to pay the rent. And could that set us back?
We are certainly highly cognizant and aware of the chance, that the threat that we might have a backslide. Certainly, we just did a study last week that came out that indicated that, you know, female founders are forced to be more capital efficient. So not surprisingly, they have less runway than their male counterparts. Yet I will say that more men are reporting that they have more concern about the future. So I think this is playing to a time when the leadership characteristics of women is coming into play. And despite the extra burdens that they're facing at this moment, women are rising to the challenge with trademark entrepreneurial resiliency, and their companies are ripe for investment. This does shift the onus onto venture capitalists, obviously, to do the hire and wire, right? It's important to be intentional about expanding your networks, getting to know female founders, especially underrepresented founders, and to be making an investment.
Sheryl Sandberg was on the show recently and talked about how women are doing a double-double shift, taking on the lion's share of the childcare and the remote schooling in addition to their full-time jobs, if they have full-time jobs. What sort of impact are you seeing on women founders who are maybe trying to get a company off the ground right now? How are they dealing with this? Or are, as you say, are they rising to the challenge perhaps better than some people might give them credit for?
Certainly. Our COVID impact study does indicate that women are spending a disproportionately larger percentage of their time. So 52% of our female founders report that they're spending 7+ hours daily on caregiving versus only 26% of the male founders. Yet they also report that there is absolutely no impact to their business. So they're finding the time in the day to accommodate and be resilient in this prospect. But again, the onus can't only be on the woman. We have to create seats at the table, open up networks, be intentional about making introductions of female founders to investors, and make sure that those connections and networks are happening so that they can get access to the capital that they need.
And what kind of trends are you seeing in terms of ideas that are being brought to the table, companies that women are trying to start? As you know, more of us are working from home, there are new challenges and also new solutions. We've seen the rise of Zoom, for example, and productivity tools that help us work remotely. How is that impacting the seed stage where ideas are being generated?
There's a lot of opportunity. We like to focus on that opportunity going forward. The next Googles and Amazons and Facebooks and Apples are going to be born out of this downturn. And so we see a lot of innovation happening across the spectrum from enterprise to consumer. One area dovetailing on what we were just talking about is family tech, where you know a lot of us are being burdened with extra responsibilities around care for young, care for our elderly parents. And so there is a boom happening in family tech in particular, huge growing market demand, and an opportunity to be making some investments in those companies.
Meantime, how are you advising companies right now, smaller companies that are trying to work through this, that, you know, need to sort of rework and figure out how to run a company remotely and build a strong culture at a time when, you know, people are really struggling managing work and home, and it's harder to be inclusive when everyone is dispersed in different places? Do you have any recommendations for how companies can be thinking about this right now that'll help them potentially in the future?
Yeah, we think it's even easier to actually be inclusive at this point in time. Virtual has tasked everybody to rethink so many different processes. People are relocating to different areas. And so there is a lot more talent availability and a chance to be thoughtful and to be focused. And so what we suggest to people is measure yourselves. Be thoughtful about how you're approaching your hiring. Be thoughtful about how you're approaching your inclusivity. And this is an issue of focus. And now you have lots of talent that's available to you. Reach out and expand your networks, expand your talent access. If you don't have access to that, please outreach to organizations like AllRaise. We're happy to assist you in connecting you and expanding your networks to make sure that diversity, equity, and inclusion is built into the fabric of your company from day one.
All right, Pam Kostka, CEO of AllRaise, thank you so much for joining us. We'll continue to follow the work that you're doing and the progress of the Visionary Voices Initiative. All right, coming up, more of Bloomberg Technology after this quick break. This is Bloomberg. Amazon's top robotics engineer, who recently defended the company's warehouse working conditions, has left the company to join an artificial intelligence startup. Brad Porter will serve as chief technology officer for Scale AI. Scale makes software to help people train autonomous driving technology and other computer vision systems. The business was valued at more than $1 billion last year. And the woman running Amazon's warehouses globally may next be tapped to become the first Black logistics head. Alicia Buller Davis was elevated to Jeff Bezos's senior leadership council earlier this month. She brings a wealth of experience running factories at General Motors. Amazon's current logistics chief, Dave Clark, will step aside to lead Amazon's consumer business early next year in the wake of Jeff Wilke's departure. And that does it for this edition of Bloomberg Technology. Bloomberg Daybreak Australia is next. That's all for now. I'm Emily Chang in San Francisco. This is Bloomberg.